Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for coming today. I'm Lucy Birmingham, the president of the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. To my very far right is our awesome interpreter, Takamatsu-san. Yoroshiku onegai shimasu. Before I introduce our three fabulous speakers, I'm very happy to tell you that this is part of our speaker series called Women Speak. We're putting the spotlight on the government's push to get women here into the workforce. Topics include women in science and technology, women in law, women in the arts, and lots more. So please do join us for those coming up. Today we are very, very honored to have three prominent women in university education. To my right is Masako Egawa, director of the University of Tokyo. In the center is Yuko Tanaka, president of Hosei University. And to her right is Kayo Inaba, who is with Kyoto University. She's the Vice President for Gender Equality and Director of the Center for Women Researchers. So, surely one of the biggest questions they're facing is Japanese academia ready for women leaders? I think many of us have this idea that top universities are dominated by conservative old men. Is that possible? And highly competitive male researchers who will do anything to protect their territory. Can this change anytime soon? Will Japan's top universities finally embrace all the great female talent in their ranks? Maybe this would help their university's world rankings. So let's hear what they have to say. Please give a warm welcome to Egawa-san, Tanaka-san, and Inaba-san. Thank you. Okay, so Tanaka-san, can you go first, please? Yeah, thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming our symposium today. I'm Yuko Tanaka, president of Hosei University. I think you know the comments, including heckling by male politicians in the Tokyo Metropolitan Assembly. And sexist remarks in our national legislature. And I have been shocked by the comments because I had thought that the Japanese men's attitude toward women had changed significantly since my years at university and graduate school. It's disappointing to realize how very little they have changed. Let me begin by relating my own experience in this area. When I was being interviewed for admission to graduate school back in 1974, one of the professors conducting the interview seems to find my application amusing. He joked, "Three males, an up, and grad school, right?" The other professors laughed along with him. This was a play on the stock phrase, "sanshoku hirunetsuki" in Japanese, or "three males and an up," referring to the supposedly pampered life of the Japanese homemaker. It didn't apply to me at all since I was unmarried and a university student. But simply because I was a woman, he immediately imagined this scenario in which I had married, become a full-time homemaker with a lot of time on my hands, and decided to go to graduate school as a kind of a hobby to relieve the boredom. I can't imagine why he would say it unless he was fundamentally uncomfortable with the idea of women in graduate school. At the time, I felt vaguely insulted since I fully intended to devote the rest of my life to research. But I didn't challenge his remark because I didn't want to risk being rejected. As it turned out, I was admitted as a graduate student thanks to my scores on the written examination. But that was when I was forced to face the fact that I would be spending my life in the place where women are looked down on in this manner. My experience illustrated the gap between our formal institutions and our social mores and attitude. The entrance examination system treated applicants fairly and equally, but the equitable system didn't lead to real equality. Women have had to work twice as hard as their male counterparts in the students and on the job. Although while putting up with contemptuous behavior and insulting jokes. In fact, when I was hired by the university in 1980, my academic supervisor advised me to work twice as hard as my male colleagues. As a researcher and an instructor, in order to prove to them that a woman could do the job. On paper, the pay and the duties of the faculty member are the same for women as for men. But in the in the actual workplace, women have to work twice as hard as men to review the playing field. And they are never free to turn down the tasks assigned them. This experience go back 40 years and 34 years. But while our systems have grown ever more equitable, equitable, it seems to me that social attitudes and assumptions have changed very little. This is the basic reason Japanese women have so few leadership opportunities today. And women like me are partly to blame because we didn't make it our business to change society by standing up and protesting. We thought it was enough to meet our challenges individually by working harder. We didn't appreciate the significance of the gap between systems and attitude, or confront the need to bring social attitude and realities into line with the goals of equality embraced by Japan's constitution and institution. And these are the figures of women teaching staff in Japan. Taken together, women represent a sizable portion of the teaching profession. And given that women made up only 8% of all full-time instructors back in 1980. The increase has been considerable. These are the figures of Japanese male and female high school graduates went on to four-year universities. Today, most Japanese women enroll in four-year universities, and the rate is almost the same as for men. And yet, when you go higher up the ladder, the gap between Japan and other countries is huge. Japan lacks 127th in the world in the portion of national legislature seats filled by women, with just 8%. France, India, and South Korea have all implemented concrete measures to boost the number of female politicians in the national assemblies, but Japan has done nothing. As for university presidents, only 8.7% were headed by women as of 2012. And virtually, those were women's university or single faculty colleges. The number of four-year comprehensive universities with women serving as both president and the chair of the board of trustees is, I'm sorry to say, exactly one. The fact that the faculty of Hosei University voted to elect a woman a president is a tribute to the institution's progressive character. Hosei University has changed a lot in the past 30 or 40 years. The number of women faculty members as a full-time teaching staff has roughly tripled, 18.2%. Faculty positions are open to all applicants as a rule, and hiring decisions are based on the research achievements and the educational qualifications. So the number of women has continued to rise. In fact, today women make up 56.6% of the full-time administrative staff. We also have a good number of male faculty members who are actively engaged in child rearing, and we all work hard to accommodate each other. Our faculty members tend to be liberal in their orientation, and our guiding principle are freedom and progress. As an institution, we are less hemmed in by prejudice and privilege than most. There was a good deal of interest in the last election for university president. Voter turnout was about 19%. Out of two candidates, a man and a woman of roughly the same age, I received 58% of the vote, not a landslide by any means. Neither of us represented a faction, and our positions were not in sharp conflict. So I think you could say that people cast their vote calmly in a thoughtful manner. There wasn't a lot of hype about the gender issue. So I don't think that determined most people's vote. But I realized during the election that this was the first time a woman had ever run for an executive position at the university. A big reason for that is that scarcely any women have served in the position of dean. Deans are elected by their undergraduate schools. It's a position of responsibility in which you chair faculty meetings, forge a consensus out of the diverse opinions aired there, and represent your school at the dean's meetings, negotiating and sometimes coming into conflict with the university's top brass. You learn a lot about university administration in the process. In some countries, people learn the ropes after they have been appointed president, but I personally feel that there is no substitute for the experience one gains in the position of responsibility such as dean of the undergraduate school. The point is that there's a process one has to go through to become a reader, whether in business or in academia. We need to make a conscious and concerted effort as an institution to include women in this process. However hard each individual woman may strive, it isn't going to be enough to change society. Recently, I began the process of formulating a new long-term vision for Hosei University. I've created a number of committees for that purpose, and one of those is the Diversity Promotion Committee, which was one of my campaign pledges. This is not just oriented to women. The fact is that many men are involved in child rearing, and a large number of other faculty members are caring for elder parents. The university also has a responsibility to employ non-Japanese faculty members in line with the nation's goals for globalization, higher education. We need to meet the diverse requirement of an aging population, of globalization, and also of universal inclusiveness, opening up the workplace to individuals with disabilities. The leadership of women in academia and business can play a critical role in promoting the diversity. Just as democracy cannot be achieved by laws and words alone, diversity and inclusion demand concerted efforts at every level of society. I believe that the university should be at the forefront of those efforts. Thank you.
Tanaka-san, thank you so much. Okay, Inaba-san, would you like to go next?
すみません。京都大学の稲葉です。お二人の間に挟まれて、私だけ日本語でお話しさせていただきます。
Hello, I've just been introduced. My name is Inaba. I come from Kyoto University. I'm very, very embarrassed by the fact that my other two colleagues are speaking in English and I'm speaking in Japanese.
よろしくお願いします。見ていただいたら分かるんですけれども、一番下のボトムが日本の、女性研究者の比率になります。で2012年現在で 13% でその値は、ブルーに示してある EU 上側が27カ国下15カ国ですけれどもその平均の半分以下という状況です。
As you can see, the bottom is where Japan is ranked. This is the proportion of female researchers, and the data was produced by the EC. This is data for 2012, but you can see that Japan has only 13% of female researchers, and this is much less than the average of the EU countries. Even for the EU 27, EU 15, at the very right-hand top, you can see that the number 13 represents less than half of the EU averages.
その後、徐々には増えてきまして、2013年に日本では 14.4% となりました。でしかしこの 14.4% っていうのはアジアの中で最も低く韓国でさえ 17.4% 5年前は日本の方が多かったんですそれがこの5年間の間にひっくり返って日本がなかなか女性の研究者が増えていっていないっていう現状が見えてます
And this shows you more specific data about the proportion of female researchers in Japan. Things have gotten a little bit better than the first slide. In 2013, 14.4% of researchers were female in Japan. That sounds like a tremendous improvement. However, it is the lowest figure of all of the Asian nations. In fact, the figure for South Korea is over 17%. 5 years ago, Japan was ahead of South Korea. However, the positions between the two countries have been reversed.
ではその女性研究者が一体どこに所属しているのかっていうのを見ていただきますと大学においては 25% ですでところが、企業の女性研究者っていうのはわずか 8% でしかありません
So where are these female researchers actually working? As you can see by this chart, 25% is where they are working, in universities. 25% of female researchers are working in universities. However, the 8% figure is for private companies. As you can see, the proportion for female researchers in private companies is very low.
で次に、じゃあこの研究者っていうのはどういう領域で研究を行っているのかというのを見ていただきますと、ヒューマニティ、あるいはアザーズって書いてあるようなところでおよそ 20%、それからサイエンス、エンジニアリング、アグリカルチャーっていうのでおよそ半分弱。であと残り 35% ほどがヘルスということになります。
So where are these female researchers working? Which fields are they active in? You can see by this chart that for humanities and others, that represents about 20%. That's where about the female researchers are located. In the sciences, engineering, and agriculture, this represents about 50%. And then about 35% comes from the healthcare area, medical, dentistry, etc.
すみません。この比率っていうのは全研究者がどういう領域で働いているかということです。それで、じゃあそのそれぞれの領域で女性研究者がどのくらいの比率でいるかっていうのを見ていただきますと、赤で囲ってあるように、 サイエンス、エンジニアリング、アグリカルチャーっていう3領域において非常に女性の比率が低いということが分かります。ヒューマニティあるいはその看護系、ファーマとか薬学っていうのは非常に女性が多いということになります。
So this previous pie chart showed you the breakdown of where the female researchers are located. And this current chart shows you that in the area indicated in red, in other words, in the sciences, in engineering, in agriculture, you see that the proportion of female researchers is extremely, extremely low. You can see actually that the proportion of female researchers is high in the humanities areas. Also, even within the medical area, it's basically the nursing field or the pharmaceutical sciences fields.
それで、じゃあ学生の比率がどうかっていうことを修士課程の学生と博士課程の学生について見ます。そうしますと他の領域と比べて、エンジニアリングだけがあたかも博士課程の学生が増えているように見えます。これの原因はアジアからの留学生に女性が多いということで、実際にアジアからの留学生ではなく日本の博士課程に進学する女性を見ると、どこの領域でも少ないということがわかります。
So now we will look at the proportion of female students that are actually studying in graduate schools. And we see that in both master's programs and PhD programs, their numbers are not very high, especially in areas in the natural sciences. However, you see...On the one hand, it looks as though in the engineering field, there are a very large number of female students in PhD programs. However, if you look at this figure more closely, you see that many of the female PhD program people that are women are actually foreign students studying in Japan. So in general, there are not that many women studying in PhD programs in Japan.
それで、実際にこれだけの大学院生がいるわけですけれども、じゃあその中で女性の、左側が PhD のスチューデントの女性の割合です。で右側がそこの中でどれだけその採用されてるか雇用されてるかっていう比率を見ますと、女性は圧倒的に少ししか少ないな女性がさらに少ない数しか採用されていっていないということを示しています。
And you can see that the problem becomes even worse when these students in these different graduate programs actually seek employment. On the left-hand side, the bars show you the percentages of people, women, who are at PhD students in PhD programs. And then it shows you the percentages of women who are actually hired on the right-hand side. And you can see that in every case, the right-hand bar is lower than the left-hand bar. In other words, fewer women are being hired from these postdoc programs.
それで、それぞれのじゃあ実際に大学で在籍している教員の職員に応じたその数あるいは比率を見ていただきますと、やはり赤で囲ってあるようにサイエンス、エンジニアリング、アグリカルチャーっていうところの教授、准教授、講師、助手って助教っていう数が非常に少なく、一方でいわゆる助手って言ってますその研究補助に近い職の女性は非常にどこの比率も高いということが分かります。
So this shows you the actual proportion of female faculty members working in Japanese universities. And again, I've indicated the main bars part of the chart in red. You see that in the sciences, in engineering, and in agriculture, the proportion of women faculty members, whether they're professors, associate professors, lecturers, or assistant professors, is quite, quite low. There is just one exception, which is that the proportion of assistants who are female is very high. The These are people who work as research assistants.
実際にではそれ以外のプレジデント、バイスプレジデントっていうのを大学の設立別に見てみます。そうしますと、国立大学では、非常にバイスプレジデントの男性の数が増えている。で、それ以外のその公立大学、私立大学ではその比率っていうか人数は大きくは変わりません。で下のところに数が書いてありますけど、現在国立大学86校、そこに勤めているのが6万3000人ほどの教員がいると、これ正規です全て。で公立大学82校、1万3000人弱、私立大学578校、10万人の教員がいると。でそこの平均の規模っていうのがその 括弧内の数字になります。そうすると国立大学は比較的大きな人数の教員を抱えているということになりますが、やはりその教員の先ほど見ていただいたと同じように、非常に女性の教員の比率、特に後で見ていただきますけれども、高い職員の女性教員の数が少ないということが分かります。で、一方で私立大学では非常に教授の数そのものが多いっていうのは、もしかしたらその教育が主体であって研究というのとは違うのかもしれません。
So, this shows you the number of, tenured members in Japanese universities, and we've kind of divided up the universities according to the type of universities, that they are, whether they are private universities or national universities or municipal, universities. Municipal is a category that includes all public, for example, prefectural, city, etc. universities. And you can see, on the left-hand side of the, left-hand chart that, in terms of presidents and vice presidents, the top posts in universities, there is a preponderance of male, presidents and vice presidents, in a national universities. For municipal and private universities, the presidents and vice presidents, male and female ratios are not so different. I would now like to draw your attention to the three lines at the bottom of this slide. You see national universities, the number of researchers in 86 universities, and the average number of researchers per university. And then you see similar data for municipal universities and private universities below that. And you can see that national universities are on average have more faculty members per university than municipal and private universities. However, as I've pointed out earlier, in terms of the top posts, whether talking about presidents or vice presidents, or just in terms of faculty overall, the proportion of women faculty members is quite low. For private universities, the numbers are much better. Part of the reason might be that what we call assistants perhaps have more responsibilities than in national universities.
実際に国立大学でも3名の学長がいらっしゃいます。お茶の水女子大学、東京学芸大学、それから京都教育大学です。で、その3校とも規模としては比較的小さな大学で、かつ2校は教育系の大学という特徴があります。で、現在旧帝大の中には1名の、いまだかつて1名の学長、総長もいらっしゃいません。
Of the national universities today, there are actually three universities that have female presidents. One is Ochanomizu University, another is Tokyo University of the Arts, the other is Kyoto University of Education. However, these three universities are distinguished by the fact that they are fairly small in size. Also, of these three universities, two of them basically focus on education. As a result, they're rather unusual among the national universities. What I would like to point out is that of the national universities that were formerly imperial universities before the war, in other words, the very large, prestigious universities, there are no and have been no presidents that were female.
実際にこれがその比率になります。と先ほど申し上げましたように、日本には3名の国立大学の学長がいらっしゃいますけれども、それ以外のバイスプレジデントの比率にしましても、当然他の教員にしても、公立大学あるいは私立大学に比べてはるかに少ないという数になっています。
So this is the chart that breaks down what I've just said previously. If we compare national universities with municipal and private university, you see that the number of vice presidents, the number of faculty members, the proportion of women is much lower for national universities than for municipal and private universities, even accounting for the fact that there are three presidents of national universities that are women.
それでこういうような状況で、文部科学省は2005年ぐらいからさあどうするのかとっていうので、2006年に、後でお話しします女性研究者のモデル育成事業っていうのを始めました。でそれに先立って、科学技術の基本計画あるいは男女共同参画基本法の中で計画が出てきているわけですけれども、第3期および第4期の時に、サイエンスで 20%、 エンジニアリングで 15%、 アグリカルチャーで 30% の女性教員を少なくとも採用していこうと。で最終的には2020年までに大学教員の割合を全国で 30% を超したいというふうに計画の中に謳われています。 で、すでに第3期に歌われてたんですけども、第3期はるかに及びませんで、第4期もそれが継続されたということで、現在第5期に向けてこの数値目標をどうするのかということをようやく考え始めておるところです。で、それ以外に、
Given this background, from about 2005, the people in the Ministry of Education decided that something must be done about this situation. As a result, in 2006, a model program was launched which would support the training and nurturing of female researchers in universities in Japan. This was also incorporated as part of the third Science and Technology Basic Plan. It was also incorporated into part of the Gender Equality Law. The third Science and Technology Basic Plan is more or less ending, and the fourth one is now being launched. In the fourth Science and Technology Basic Plan, as is written here in the big first paragraph, the goal is to try to achieve 20% of faculty members for women faculty members in the sciences, 15% in the engineering departments, and 30% in the agricultural field. Having said all of this, however, the fundamental goals that were set in the third basic plan were not achieved. They were therefore continued in the successor program, the fourth science and technology basic plan, and already discussions are underway about the fifth science and technology basic plan to see about what kind of numerical targets could be incorporated.
でこういう計画に加えて、じゃあ政府が何をできるかということで、文部科学省はその各大学に対して、まあ、ファンディングという形でみんなアプライしないといけないんですけれども、いろいろな環境を醸成するためのお金を出すということを始めましたし、でやはりそのいわゆるSTEMって言われているような自然科学系の女性を増やさないといけないと。いうので、裾野拡大というので女子中高生のためのそのいろいろな事業を始めてます。
So again, what can the government do to try to alleviate the situation at MEXT, the Ministry of Education? They have started to launch different programs which universities must apply for, and these are basically funding programs to help universities fund different activities to encourage women to stay on in universities, also to create better, more supportive environments so that women can continue to work, especially in what we call the natural sciences area, where there are so few women that are active today. One way to do this is to increase the number of junior high school and high school students, women, young girls, who might consider a future in the sciences. Therefore, different programs are being launched for these lower grades.
それで、2006年京都大学も非常に男女共同参画も遅れていた中でこのモデル育成事業にアプライして採択されることができました。おそらくこんなに遅れている大学を何とかしないといけないという文科省の方の意向が働いているのではないかと私たちは理解してますけれども、でこの時からです、私がこの女性研究者支援っていうのに関わり始めたのは、でそこの中にありますと、まあセンターを始めたんですけども、下の方を見てください。カウンセラーを雇って、その女性がその悩み事を抱えたときにサポートできるようにするとか、それから、チャイルドケアがある時期、あるいはその介護っていう時の女性教員が働けなくなる、その間にその研究実験補助者を雇用できるように大学としてサポートすると。いうこと、それから病気になった子を大学の、医学部の付属病院と協力してそこの中で病児保育室を開設してそこで預かると、あるいはその待機乳児っていうのが非常に問題になってますけれども、待機の生後15ヶ月までの正規の保育所に入れない子をサポートするとかっていうことを始めました。でそれはこれ3年間の授業でしたけれども、終了後も現在も継続してます。
So I mentioned earlier that in 2006 this model program was launched. However, Kyoto University was very, very late coming to the scene and taking advantage of this program as a result. I believe that Kyoto University finally decided to join this model program because of pressure or advice, strong advice from the Ministry of Education. It is since that time that I've been involved in these different programs to try to support women researchers and women faculty members in universities. One of the first things that we did was establish a center, and the details of the programs programs that we run at the center are listed on this slide. We have counselors who listen to women and try to help them, try to offer support for some of the problems that they're having, whether it's childcare or nursing care, whether it's trying to balance work and family, whether it is that different assistant researchers are employed during a period when certain faculty members cannot work because of childcare and nursing care responsibilities. Also, in terms of childcare help, there is a facility that will accept children up to 15 months of age who cannot find room in public daycare centers. These are the kinds of things that we are doing at the center. It's gone on for 3 years, and even after the 3 year period, it is still continuing to operate.
このような事業ですけれども、その実験研究補助者の雇用っていう事業そのものは現在も文科省の方でこれだけを抜き出した形で継続されております。
So again, this fundamental program to try to support researchers is and allow them to continue with research and experimentations while they have other responsibilities is something that is being fully supported by MEXT.
でこれがまあ京都大学がやっているものですけども、ちょっともう時間もあれですので、実際に京大がどのくらいの教員がいるかというのを最後にお示しします。そうしますと、現在、教授が 5.9、准教授が 8.8、講師が 12.8、それから助教、アシスタントプロフェッサーが 12.4、平均で正規の教員は 9%。で特定有機という任期制のものを入れて 10.7% ということです。ところが旧程度の代の中ではおそらく最下位だと思います。
So the previous slide showed you different photographs that showed you the activities of the center, but because we don't have much time, I'm just going to skip over to my last slide. This shows you the ratio of female faculty members within my university, Kyoto University. And you can see from the pie charts at the bottom of the slide, professors 5.9%, associate professors 8.8%, lecturers 12.8%, assistant professors 12.4%. The average of female faculty members, the ratio is only about 9%. And this is for full-time tenured faculty members. And if we include those faculty members with a limited term employment, that number goes up from 9% to 10.7%. But 10.7% in terms of female faculty members is ratio is a very, very low number. It's probably the lowest among the former imperial universities.
まあ、こんなような状況ですけれども、なんとかして学内のその賛同を得つつ、これからも女性研究者支援を続けたいと思っています。ありがとうございました。
So again, this is a situation in our university. It is a very, very difficult one. However, I intend to continue to do my very, very best to support women faculty members and researchers working in our university. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah, some startling numbers there. Thank you so much for sharing that. Okay, Egawa-san, お願いいたします。
Thank you very much, and I'm very pleased to have this opportunity to speak at the FCCJ this afternoon. My name is Masako Egawa, Executive Vice President, and I'm one of the seven Executive Vice Presidents at the University of Tokyo who work closely with the President to run the entire university. And my responsibility include diversity, development, outreach, which means both alumni relations, and also corporate relations, and international affairs. I have a different background from the two previous speakers because I come from private sector. I worked in the banking industry for 20 years. And then in 2001, I was asked to run the research center for Harvard Business School, my alma mater. This this helped me to enter the field of academia. And in 2009, when President Hamada was trying to form his cabinet for his presidency, he asked me to join his management team. So I joined the University of Tokyo in 2009, and I'd like to introduce my very first project. This was to upgrade women's restrooms. Universities tend to allocate its resources to research and education. As a result, administered buildings constantly suffer from underinvestment. So when I arrived in 2009, the women's restrooms were old, unpleasant. Japanese toilets accounted for nearly half, and they were not used frequently. And total areas for women's restrooms were half the space allocated for men's restrooms. This was because when the administrative building was built in early 70s, women were a small minority in the academic staff, and nobody noticed that women's number increased. Now, women account for about 40% of the administrative staff. So we changed that. We are tackling the same problem for the entire university right now. We have those very old bathrooms throughout our campuses. So we reviewed those restrooms and currently trying to spend about $4 million, US dollars, to upgrade the women's restrooms at all campuses in 50 buildings to improve comfort and security. So this women's toilet problem, in my view, is very symbolic of a challenge at the University of Tokyo. Women are still minority at our university. So this is a snapshot of the women's ratio at our university. So you can see those numbers are very, very small at the senior executive level throughout the faculty members, also administrative staff. And I became executive vice president only because I was hired from outside, because in our university's 137-year history, we have had no female deans, heads of faculties or schools. So even today, when I go to meetings, there are 30, 40, 50 people in the room, and I'm the only woman. So this is a stark contrast to the rapid changes taking place in a business community, as well as the emphasis Prime Minister Abe is placing on this issue. So this is the number, gender distribution of faculty members. Our situation is not much different from two other universities. So even though that women account for 11% of the total, you can see that, they are concentrated at the junior level. And faculty ratio is much lower compared to the ratio of female in the graduates among the graduate students. Even more depressing and problematic, in my view, is the fact that the women account for less than 20% of the entering undergraduate students. Some our admission system is very, very fair. You probably know that our admission is based on a paper exam and very, very competitive. The reason women account for less than 20% of the students is because women students account for less than 20% of the applicants. Basically, smart women don't apply to the University of Tokyo. Or we sometimes joke within our university that for the difference of a 30%, you know, between, because women should account for 50%, the extra 30% is allocated to less smarter male students, right? Anyway, we like to, because we believe that the talents are should be distributed evenly, we like to increase the number of women applicants, and we are making all kinds of efforts, but partly because science engineering account for about two-thirds of our undergraduate students, it has been very difficult to increase the number of women students, and it has been almost flat for the last 10 years. I even hear that even today, many parents tell their daughters, don't go to the University of Tokyo because you have trouble getting married. So we are making all kinds of efforts to increase the women undergraduates. So we invite many high school students to our campus and laboratories. We are planning to do open campus next week. We're encouraging female undergraduates to visit their alma mater or high schools they graduated. In the video that we introduce our university, we feature women students who are majoring in science and engineering subjects. I'd like to move to the international comparison. University of Tokyo is a member of the Association of Pacific Rim Universities, which is an association of 45 leading research universities based in 16 economies across the Pacific Rim. So it includes Americas, Australia, as well as many Asian countries. And in that association, we launched Asia Pacific Women's in Leadership Project, which is a gender equity project last year, and I was asked to be the chair. And in this project, we produced a gender gap report comparing the state of women across the member universities. And I'd like to introduce some of the statistics. So this is the profile of the senior executives and deans. And I'm sorry, the graph is a bit small, but you can see all the Japanese universities at the very bottom of this graph. Some people may feel, well, America and Australia may have higher ratio, but we are behind compared to all Asian universities. This is the gender distribution of professors. Again, Japanese universities are stacked at the bottom. And this is the gender distribution of administrative managers. So again, numbers are slightly better than professors and senior executives. But again, Japanese universities are at the very bottom. If you're interested, this gender gap report is available on the web. If you can search by APRU and APWell, you can read everything. And it's a very depressing, in my view. So we have been, in addition to producing gender gap report, we have been organizing workshop to tackle this issue. And earlier this month, thanks to Kyoto University and Professor Inaba Sensei, we organized a workshop, and 50 participants from 14 universities, one institute, including non-APRU members, participated. And during the discussions, we decided that we should put together a proposal, which is titled to Shinagawa Proposal, and we basically try to make points about the five issues. So this proposal has been distributed for you with the other things, but you can see that we are basically making proposals that we should make increase the women in faculty executive positions and also adopt women-friendly policies and also zero tolerance for the harassment. So I hope that you understand this situation, but I truly believe that the women in academia are underutilized assets. So I think by increasing diversity at the Japanese universities, they should be able to enhance its competitiveness. We hope that all of us in this room can work together to improve the gender equity issue in higher education in Japan. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Inaba-san. Wow, okay, bottom of the pack. It's a little bit depressing. All right, so questions, please. First from the press. Yes, Karsten, go ahead. Can you please, everybody, give your name and your media affiliation?
Germans from Frankfurt Allgemeine Zeitung in Germany. All you three talked about the gap between institutional framework and attitudes in society, more or less. So the Prime Minister seems to be convinced it is necessary to promote women. Opinion polls show, especially young people, the younger generation, is getting more and more conservative. They are not so very happy with making career, being involved in society. So what is your impression with young students you meet more than I do? Is there really a trend to more conservative attitudes, as you might not find a husband becoming a student at Tokyo University? And can you really change attitude of society just by a speech of the Prime Minister. What has to be done to change this? Do you need quota? Whatever could be done. This story you talked about, Tokyo Metropolitan Council and the diet, and so this, you should go to Izakaya Friday evening in Japan and talk to Japanese businessmen. This would be interesting for you too. So how can you really change society, just by law or by whatever?
ドイツの新聞のものでございます。今までのお話を聞いておりますと、やはりそのいろんな機関、あるいはその制度が変わろうとしたと、もう変えようといたしましても、社会全体の考え方というのにおきましては、やっぱりちょっと考えの違いがあるんじゃないでしょうか。つまり一方では制度がの変更というのがあるんですが、一方ではその社会世論の考えがありますので、そこに大きなギャップがあるというふうに考えております。明らかにその、首相は、女性をもっともっとその昇進させるべきだというふうには言ってるんでございますが、各世論調査の結果を見ますと、女性、特に若い女性がますますその保守的になってきているというふうに思います。皆様が若いその女性をたくさん見てらっしゃると思いますが、やっぱりこの保守化というのはかなりあると思いますでしょうか。そしてリーダーがそのどんなにその日本は変わるべきだ、考え方を変えるべきだというふうに主張しても、実際に社会を変えることができるんでしょうか。そしてまた社会を変えるためには逆に何が必要なんでございましょうか。法律あるいは制度を変えるだけで、これは実現するんでしょうか。この前の家賃問題もあったりしましたし、まあ、ビジネスマンの考え方もいろいろあると思うんでございますが、
どれでも anybody can answer that, so it's up to you. Okay.
I see that some women students may be a bit more conservative than previous generation, but I also see many, many outgoing students. I think the challenge at the university is because the hiring decisions are made locally. So it's a very decentralized structure. So president cannot just adopt a policy, let's make women at the whatever percent, and then make sweeping changes. So that's part one of the challenges. But I think press can make a lot of difference by changing the opinions of the society. We recently had a meeting of a President's Council. This is an international advisory board of the presidents. And the view expressed that in there was that we may need a quota. But this is how we do this may be a very tricky, because we always talked about how quota may not jeopardize the quality of the academia.
Thank you. Tanaka-san, did you want to answer that?
では、すみません、私は日本語で、先ほど、職員の、私の大学の職員の数は 56.6% が女性であるということを言いました。しかし、その中で管理職は 7% です。で、そのようなことから、私は関心を持って女性職員に聞いたことがあります。で、そうしましたら、やはりそういう立場に、責任のある立場にはなりたくない。なぜかというと、非常に労働時間が長くなって、そして給与は低くなる、そして大変重荷になる。つまり実際的なことを考えると、なかなかそういう立場、管理職にはなれないという返事があります。
So I mentioned earlier that the percentage of workers in my university, employees of my university, 56% were women. However, only 7% of the managerial posts are held by women. And I decided to do a sort of survey and ask different employees if they wanted have managerial positions. And the general answers that I received was that most people did not want to assume that kind of responsibility. Part of that, reasons for that, is that they would have to work longer hours, they would see a cut in their salaries, and the burdens that they would bear for having that much responsibility was a little bit too much more than they wished to have.
一方、学生を見ていると、女性の学生は大変活発で、議論が好きで、そして、勉強もよくしています。学生時代は女性たちは大変、いい状態で勉強しているのですが、おそらく卒業すると、同じようになる。つまり、あまりこう仕事の場で責任を持ちたくないというふうになるのではないかと私は恐れています。 で、まず女性の意識が変わる必要はあって、でもそのためには、やはり社会でのサポートが必要です。そして例えば私の大学では、女性を今まで、自分で、手を挙げて、つまり立候補して、こう管理職になるという方法を取ってたんですが、今度変えました。つまり周りの人たちが信頼を寄せてぜひ管理職になってほしいという人を選ぶというそういう方法にしました。そういくつもの方法で女性が積極的ではないけれども管理職になってしまって、そしてそこで何とかやっていくという経験を積んでいく必要があると思います。
However, on the other hand, when I look at young students, I see that many of them are very, very forward-looking. They're very, very active. They love to debate. They love to study. They're full of vitality and energy. So while they are students, women are in a very, very good state. However, one of my greatest fears is that when they graduate, they will join the ranks of their superiors. In other words, other women who also shirk from taking on the responsibilities of becoming taking on an important managerial position. Certainly, as you've pointed out, women need to change. Their self-awareness and their awareness of their possibilities needs to change, but they also need very much the support of a society. So we have taken different steps within my universities. For example, one of the things that I've done at my university is that until now, when women were promoted to managerial positions, it was done on a volunteer basis. In other words, a woman would raise her hand and say, I think I can take on this responsibility. However, we've changed the system so that women are chosen because people around them, people who have worked with them, people who have studied with them, think that this is a person who would be good as a managerial position person. And so what I'm saying is that we've taken different steps to ensure that even though these women are not necessarily all that active or proactive or saying that I want this or I want that, being forced to take on a managerial position and then trying to see how it works is actually a way to encourage women to become managers.
Okay. 今田中先生がおっしゃったように若い子たち学生は非常に女の子たちは意欲的ですしいろんなものに積極的に取り組んでます。ところが会社に勤めてで結婚して子供が生まれた途端に徐々に職から遠ざかっていってしまうっていうのが現実なんですね。であるところの会議の時に話が出たんですけどもその会社は IT の会社でその部署には50人いて女性はそのうちの2人であると1人が育休に帰ってきた上司は大変だろうからもうちょっと違う部署に移したそしたらその女性は鬱になっちゃったとっていうことはその女性が大変だろうからというサポートの仕方っていうそのものをもう一遍考え直す必要があるってことなんですよ。女の人一生懸命やろうと思ってるのに大変だからねちょっと他のところで仕事してよって言われれば当然自分は切り捨てられたような気持ちになってしまう。その人がその仕事を続けられるようなサポートシステムっていうのをその企業も大学も続けていく必要があると思います。で確かにその安倍内閣によっていろいろなその女性採用雇用の促進っていうことが謳われてます。で大学にとってのやっぱり難しさっていうのは企業はトップダウンで例えば2020年までに 30% って言ったら何百人何千人って取る中から 30% 女性を採用すればいいんです。で試験をすれば女性はとても優秀なんですね。ところが大学は1回のその人事の選考の中に1つのポジションしかないわけです。ここの分野のこの領域をやってる人をさ何十人の中から取りましょうということなので人事はオールはなんで1人取られるか取られないかで最後マスにした時にあ何パーセントしかないっていう現状があって大学の中でさあ女性を増やしていこうっていうのは非常に難しさがあります。ちょっと話がずれましたけれども。
As Professor Tanaka just mentioned, yes, when I look at young women students, I also think they're all very proactive, they're ambitious, they're very, very optimistic about their futures, and they have many, many plans. However, when they graduate, things change. They enter a company, they get married, they have children, and over time, eventually, they lose that vitality and that ambition. For example, there was a meeting that I recently attended, and conversation turned to an IT company which had only just a few female employees. One had just returned from maternity leave and it was thought that her superior because having come back from maternity leave and having to worry about childcare, would find it difficult to use her or decided to switch her to a different position. It might have been done in part because the superior or the company thought that because she was having probably going to have difficulties raising her child, it would be easier if she were moved to a different position. The term used is taihen, which is really, really difficult, meaning difficult for all parties concerned. The point is, however, that this woman, because she was moved to a different department, different from where she had originally worked, eventually became depressed. She suffered from depression. The point is that when people realize that a woman coming back from maternity leave is in a taihen position, meaning that she really has a very difficult, you know, multiple responsibilities, at that point, what is necessary is for the company or organization to be able to support her so she can get through this difficult period and not move her to a different section that necessarily she didn't want to go to. The point is that in her case, she was transferred to a different position. It might have been done out of kindness, but for whatever reason, she felt that she was no longer needed, that her career options were being cut, and therefore she fell into depression. Therefore, companies, universities must think of ways to support women who do want to continue to work. Also, although Prime Minister Abe is pushing for more employment and promotion of women, it is very, very difficult, especially for universities, to follow through on some of these targets. For example, there is this idea of 30% of leadership positions filled by women by 2020. But for universities, which employ hundreds or thousands of people, having this percentage figure, to reach this percentage figure, is very, very difficult. It was mentioned earlier that the decision-making process is difficult, is different in universities compared to companies. And in particular, in universities, especially when you're talking about research research aspects, usually when a post opens up, it's just one post, there's just one person that's going to be employed out of many, many different applicants that are chosen. And a person that is chosen needs specific experiences, specific backgrounds, specific abilities. And the best person for that post is chosen. And then over time, when these kinds of personnel decisions are made, you find that you have not reached that ideal percentage of women employed. So I'm saying in universities, it is very, very difficult to achieve these kinds of large numbers of women hires.
Okay, thank you. All right, more questions? Martin, please go ahead.
Martin Kölling with the German Financial Daily Handelsblatt. Two questions. One is about quota. You mentioned it already. In Germany and also in many other cases in Japan, yeah, people found out that voluntary goals not really lead to fast progress. I would like to know, what is the situation in Japan and what is the possibility that maybe a quota will be put in place, maybe not a 30% quota, which is really extraordinarily high, but a quota, a more practical, more reasonable quota put in place in some areas, in management and universities, to slowly build up female participation in management. And second question, we had Carlos Ghosn, the president of Nissan, the CEO of Nissan, speaking here at the club. And he said Nissan is pushing very much but for female participation in management, but he wants to progress relatively slowly. He said he wants to reach 10% participation in management until 2017, because he said, what we need is positive role models, not pushing women in management position and then half of them are failing. But he said we have to make sure that these women are well, have experienced enough to basically also to be able to fulfill the position. So what is your thinking about Mr. Ghosn's position?
Do you want to go first?
Okay.
Sorry, I'm sorry.
プログラムよりはやっぱりクォーター制がいいという人が多くいるんでございますが、日本での現状はどうなんでしょうか。クォーター制というのは、ある程度ある形で導入される可能性についてお教えいただけますでしょうか。この 30% をいきなり、という設定するということはもうちょっと非現実的なお話ではないかと思うんでございますが、例えばその、大学の中での管理職の何パーセントとか、まあ、現実的なそういうようなクォーター制というのは、導入されるということは可能でございますでしょうか。で、先日2つ目の質問でございますが、カーロス・ゴーンさんがここで話したんでございます。やっぱり日産の中でも管理職の女性の割合を増やしたいというふうに彼が言ったんでございますが、非常にそのゆっくり、まあ、比較的ゆっくりしたアプローチを取りたいというふうに言っているんでございます。2017年まで 10% を目指すというふうに彼が言ったんでございます。なぜゆっくりというアプローチを取っているかということですが、無理やりたくさんの女性をいきなり増やして、そして半分ぐらいがやっぱりその、まあ、仕事ができないとかいろんな問題が出てきて失敗してしまうということになりますと、良いロールモデルというのが育たないのではないかというふうに彼が言ったんです。ゆっくり本当に経験がある方、有能な方たちだけをプロモーションして、徐々にその女性の割合を増やしたいというふうに言っているんですが、それについてどう思いますでしょうか。
私の方からお答えさせていただきます。先ほどのクォーター制ですけれども、確かにその第4期科学技術基本計画の中に数値目標は出てます。で、かつその国立大学は中期計画中期目標の中で一定の数値を上げることも要請されており、しかもその達成度を明記することも要請されているということなんです。ところが国立大学の中で実際にその数値目標を明確にして、公表するというようなことをしているというところは、まあ非常に少ないと思います。唯一その一時期今年で終わるんですけれども、加速モデルっていう女性研究者の採用を加速させるっていうモデルがありました。そこの中では実際に数値目標を置き、でそこの中で達成できたかできなかったかっていう判断だけで評価がなされていくっていう事業がありましたけれども、一部の大学では確かに達成ができました。で、その一つのいい例が九州大学の例です。
First of all, in regard to your quota, question, as I mentioned in my slide, there is this fourth basic plan, action plan for the science and technology fields, and there are specific targets that were included. And there's also a fundamental plan in which national universities were supposed to disclose the actual figures for their women faculty members percentages. They were also supposed to announce and disclose whether or not they had attained the target figures that had been presented in this action plan. But the reality is that very, very few national universities have actually made these kinds of information, these figures public. The only exception to this is that, I think I mentioned this earlier, there was this model program to accelerate the promotion of women researchers in universities. And there was a fundamental question that was asked, were you able to attain the target figures there, or were you not? And that was the only thing that they had to answer, and only some of the national universities made this information public. One was Kyushu University.
九州ユニバーシティでは女性枠として女性しかアプライできないポジションっていうのを同時に一つずつではなくて複数を提示するっていうことをしました。そうすることによって非常にたくさんの女性が応募してきた。でそこの中から優秀な女性を採用したというケースがあります。そうしますと通常の人事ですと女性は往々にしてどうせ出してもダメだろうからやめようっていうので非常に女性のアプリケーションが少ないんですね。ところが女性しか応募できないっていうので非常にたくさんの女性が応募してそこの中から優秀な女性を採用できたということがあります。で一部他の大学でもその女性枠っていうのを実際にその行っているところもポツポツとは出てきております。
So what I'm saying about Kyushu University is that they even had a specific program to accelerate the numbers of female researchers in the university. And normally, as I mentioned earlier, when a post becomes available, there are many, many applicants for this one position. However, most female researchers don't even apply because they think they have absolutely no chance of getting that position. However, Kyushu University decided to create some openings, and when some openings became available, they would only accept female applicants. Previously, women were reluctant to even apply for these posts, but when they heard that only women could apply, they applied in very, very large numbers. And Kyushu University did this not only for one single post, but they did this for multiple posts. As a result, there were many, many women that were employed. There are some other, but only a few other universities who have taken similar measures, again, to accelerate the numbers of female researchers.
もう一つセカンドクエスチョンの方ですけれども、指導的な女性研究者が少ない理由として科学技術の報告書つい最近出たんですけれども、そこの中では、一番目が家事との両立が困難だけど、その上でその途中離職や休職が多い、それから指導的立場にある世代の女性比率が低い、それから業績評価において育児介護に対する配慮がないということが挙げられていて、一方で女性研究者が直面する課題として、やはりその家庭と仕事の両立が困難、育児期間後の復帰が困難で、その職場環境がその女性に優しくないで、同じように業績評価っていうのが挙げられています。ということは、やはりロールモデルっていうのが非常に少ないで、ロールモデルがないのに突然はい、あなた教授って言われても、じゃあその自分が教授として何ができるか、例えば大学であれば、で教授になった途端にいっぱい委員会の仕事が増えて、あっちにもこっちにも少ない女性は引っ張り出されて、でどれもこれも初めての委員会でただ黙って座ってるっていうのはダメなんですよね。だから女性は女性としてのそのなんだ、みんなとの人間関係の輪を作ることが非常に優れているので、やはり誰かのにモデルになってもらって、その人がどういうことをしているのか、その人の話を聞きつつ、やっぱり それをしていく上での大変さ、あるいはその背中を見ている人たちがどうしていったらいいのかっていうサジェッションを与えられるっていうような環境っていうものが作られていく必要があるのではないかなというふうに思います。
In regard to your second question, there was recently a report that was issued about the science and technology fields and about the lack of women in leadership research positions in these fields. And there were some reasons given in the report as to why there were so few women, and it had to do with most of the things that I'm sure most of you will understand. For example, the difficulty of balancing life and work, nursing care, child care, the difficulty of returning back to work, the difficulty of not having good role models because there are so few, very few women in leadership positions to begin with. And also, when one is assessed for one's work in terms of future salary, future promotions, etc., the fact that women have to deal with childcare responsibility and nursing care responsibilities are not at all taken into consideration in the assessment progress process is considered to be a great difficulty. On the other hand, when female researchers were interviewed and asked what they felt were the biggest challenges facing them, they gave a list of almost similar topics. In other words, they felt that it was very difficult to balance life and work, very difficult to be able to return to work after taking maternity leave, difficult to work in an environment which was not sympathetic to their needs, and also the fact that their balancing these difficult personal responsibilities of childcare and nursing care was not taken into account when they were being assessed for the work that they did. So you can see that the issues are very, very clear. What is missing is that there are so very few role models for women in leadership positions. With so few women role models, suddenly for a woman to be told, you're going to be a professor starting from tomorrow, it's a very, very difficult thing for them. First of all, they find that they are burdened with a tremendous amount of work that they have to take home with them. They find that because there are so few women in their positions, they are pulled into one meeting after another. And when you attend a meeting, you can't just simply sit there and be quiet. You have to make some kinds of contributions. So what I think is important for women in the future is, because women are very, very good at communicating with each other, at building good human relationships, what is important for women to be able to find even one good role model, a superior who has had experience in managerial positions, and talk with that person, listen to that person, learn from that person, have suggestions from that person. I think that is the only way that things are going to improve.
Thank you.
法政大学でも数値目標を掲げています。教員と職員の10年先までの徐々に増やしていく数値目標です。数値目標は必要だと思います。で、なぜかと言いますと、女性の多くは自分が管理職のとして仕事ができるかどうかについて判断ができないんです。つまり管理職とはどういう仕事なのかわからないんですね。つまりやってみないとわからないんです。ですからある種の数値目標の枠の中で、まあ仕方なくあまりポジティブでなくなるというケースがあってもいいと思っています。で、その管理職に就いた時にその何が必要なのか、つまりその仕事を続けていくために自分の力あるいは条件として何が足りないのかを理解しながら周りに相談していく、あるいは要求していくことが初めてできます。なる前から要求できないんですね。ですからやはりそういう枠を作って、まあ自分を励ましてでもやってみようかと思う女性を増やしていくしかないと思うんですね。で、ただしその人から相談なり要求があったりした場合にはやはり組織はそれに対してちゃんと責任を持って答えていかなければならないと、そういうふうに思っています。
I think I mentioned this before, but at my university, Hosei University, we have set precise, specific numerical targets, both for employees and for faculty members. And I believe that over time, they're not a drastic or dramatic figures. However, over time, I think we need to gradually, incrementally increase the ratio of faculty and employees who are women. As I mentioned earlier, because there are so few women in managerial positions, women generally don't even have the ability to assess themselves as correctly as to whether or not they have what it takes to become a manager, because there are so few people ahead of them that have that are women and who are managers, they can't even have anything to compare themselves to. So as I mentioned, by having these numerical targets, basically sort of forcing a person, a woman, even though she might be reluctant at first to take on a managerial position, that is when she begins to learn, and she begins to learn about her own capabilities and possibilities. And that is also when she begins to learn what it is that she lacks or what kind of help and support that she needs. And once she identifies what she lacks or what she needs, then she will be in a position to be able to ask others for help or for support. But unless she is first in that managerial position, she cannot be in a position to ask for support or help. Another thing that I think is very important is that when this woman begins to understand what it is that she needs in terms of help and support, then the organization that hired her must be prepared to offer her that support and help.
Thank you. Yep.
When I mentioned quota was discussed at the president's meeting, this was a recommendation by the external board members, international advisors. So we have not had a chance to discuss this internally yet, so I cannot really comment officially about what we are going to do on this. But let me make a few observations. Whenever we discuss quota, we always discuss the how we should balance between quota and quality, because women are still small minority of the professors, as we discussed. But when people are making hiring decisions, they are trying to hire the best person for the university. And I think they're not trying to prejudice women. On the other hand, there's a problem of unconscious bias. Because I read paper recently that the there was a research paper done based on the experiments of basically in the United States. They created a resume of identical resume. One is for the woman's name and one is men's name, and distributed to thousands of people within the university and collected. And the results showed that the identical resume for the man name, people recommended salary at 3,000 $1,000 higher than the other women. And depressing thing is that the women, even women themselves, were making recommendations. So they are distinguished between men's resume and women's resume. So this is a very deep-seated problem. Inaba-sensei talked about that many, very few universities have external objective. And we actually have had an objective for the number of female students. When President Hamada became president, one of the numerical targets we made clear to the public was to increase the number of female students to 30% by 2020, and this was in 2010. And you have seen in an earlier graph that for the past 4 years, we haven't made any progress. So we are having so many difficulties, and so for this reason, we may have to have a little bit more radical initiative, but we are still debating how we can increase the number of applicants to a university. Thank you.
Okay, Kaldon, actually, wait a minute. I just have a question. First, can I ask my question, please? Because it directly relates to what Egawa-san has just said. A few weeks ago, I had a chance to go to a seminar where astronaut Naoko Yamazaki was speaking, and she was saying to everybody that she, when she was in high school, which is the time that students are required to choose their major in high school, unlike in the United States, where you can choose your major in your second sophomore year. She was actually considering not going into science and engineering. She thought it would be too challenging. And she found that a lot of the students, and later she learned that a lot of the younger people in high school, the younger girls, young women in high school, feel the same way, that they're very reluctant to go into this serious science and engineering because it might be too much of a risk for them. So I'm wondering if the universities would consider changing the major system instead of having the choice be required to be made in high school, move a little bit more to the international way, in the US way, and allow the students, women students, all students, to choose their major in their sophomore year when they get, when they have a wider sense of what they're going to be studying. I think Takamatsu-san, can you translate that?
お分かりだったかもしれませんが、先日セミナーに参加したのでございますが、宇宙飛行士の山崎直子様がお話ししていたのでございます。で、彼女が高校の時、自分の大学の専攻を考えると決めなきゃいけなかったんですけれど、理系に行くのはちょっと難しいかもしれないと非常にその、迷ったとおっしゃったんです。で、今でも若い女性は高校の時にその、理系に行くのか文系に行くのか、専攻を何にするのかということを考えると非常にその躊躇する部分があるという話が出ているんですけれど、欧米ではの多くの大学ではやはりその専攻は大学に入ってから、2年生とか3年生の時に決めるわけでございますが、やっぱり日本もそのようなシステムに変える、そういうようなことはいかがでございますでしょうか。高校の段階でまだやっぱりその世の中のことは分からない、自分が本当に理系についていけるかどうか分からない、そういう若い段階でその決めなきゃいけないというシステムがちょっと弊害になっているのではないでしょうか。
Do you want to answer that? Yeah, if you don't mind.
At our university, we actually have a system very similar to the American universities. So many students come under a very broad category. And then after they have spent 2 years at our Komoba campus, basically surveying different subjects, they can choose their major. There's a competitive process, so it's a little bit different from the major in the United States, but they have opportunity to basically to go anywhere. So I think the more important problem, I think, is that the we should really encourage teenagers, including junior high school students, to really take interest in science and engineering, because I think as a society, we are making influencing women students to push them toward literature, education, and more womanly subjects.
Okay, thank you very much. Sorry, we're kind of running out of time. So, Khaldun, why don't you go ahead and ask your question? Yeah.
Thank you very much for coming. My name is Khaldun Azhari, Panorate News. I have a really brief question. What would be different if women quota is higher than now? I mean, what kind of benefits the education system or the society will get out of this change of quota? Thank you.
その採用についてでございますが、そのまあ女性を多く取るようなまあクォータ制を導入したといたしましたら、社会はどうやって変わっていくと思いますでしょうか。まあ、社会が、あるいはその教育界がどのように、まあ、どのようなあのメリットなどがあると思いますでしょうか。まあ、大量の女性が採用されるようになったということでございます。
Of course, it depends on the level of quota, but I think as Professor Inaba mentioned, the current situation is that the women are such a minority that the many talented women don't even bother to apply. So if we set the quota at a reasonable level, we may try to encourage women to apply and then gradually increase. I also discussed the quota for the students, because I already discussed that our problem is that we have a very fair competitive admission process, but the women don't apply, even though in many leading universities around the world, including Harvard, Stanford, MIT, Oxford, Cambridge, women are almost 50%. And so in order to get to that and increase, basically try to, we may be able to signal that the women should try to aim higher. But again, I think it's very important for us to set the level so that it looks very reasonable and not jeopardize quality.
いいですか？
やっぱり女性が今は非常に女性が少ないっていうので、どんな会議に行っても私それこそ江川先生がおっしゃったように私たちだけっていうので、結局男性との意思の疎通とか。っていうことがなかなかできにくいことがあるんですね。男性はオールドボーイズネットワークと称していろんなところでネットワークが作れてるのに、女性である私たちだけはちょっとマージナルなところにいる感じ、疎外感があってなかなか入っていけない。そういうところに複数の女性がいればいろんな情報も共有できるわけです。で、先ほどの田中先生のお話の時もそうでしたけど、やっぱり女性を引き上げてそこの中で経験させて育てていくっていう必要がある。本当にその通りだと思います。でもそこの中で一人じゃなくて複数を同時にっていうこともやっぱり大切なんですよね。で、兄弟はつい最近その総長の選挙があって新しい総長になる。で、そこの中で今のところ私しかいないっていう状況で、もう少し女性を増やしてくださいって次期総長のところに談判につい最近に行きまして、で、そのでも部局長経験者もほとんど誰も、私だけが部局長経験者唯一ので、誰もいないじゃないのって言われたので、別にすぐさまその学部長にしてくださいとか、その副学長にしてくださいっていう意味ではないです。でも理事の下で大学の経営っていうのはどういうふうに動いていくのかっていうことを見て覚えていく人たちを育てていけば、次の世代は育ってくるんではないですかっていう話に行ったんですよ。だから複数っていうことがとても重要です。だからそういう意味でクォーター制はとても重要なんですね、ある部分で。
So again, as was mentioned earlier, there are so few women in manager posts now. In fact, when there are symposiums or seminars or meetings such as this on this kind of topic, it's always us three that tend to be called. And so what is very, very important, I believe, to promote women is to have more women, just large numbers. I believe very much in some kind of a quota system. When we... there are so few of us, it is very, very difficult for us, for women to sort of be able to share information, to be able to kind of have similar thoughts, to immediately be able to speak, to be able to communicate and share ideas without even actually speaking. What I mean by this is that men tend to have old boys networks. They kind of understand each other. There's a camaraderie that exists so that they understand each other without actually having to speak in great detail. However, when we encounter meetings where these men are all understanding each other in this way, the three of us, or
women are in our positions, because there's so few of us, we feel marginalized, we feel ostracized. So that's why I very much support what Professor Tanaka is saying, that we need to be able to train more and more women to become managers. And it's not just good to have one outstanding person or another good outstanding person. What's important is to have multiple women being promoted. Recently, there was an election for the presidency of my university, Kyoto University. I went to this gentleman who is going to be the next president, and I explained to him that we must somehow promote more women. But he responded by saying, first of all, there aren't that many candidates available. In fact, I'm the only woman that has had experience being the head of a division, head of a department, and there are no other women that have similar experiences. But I told him that it doesn't have to be right away that immediately you you take a woman and put her in a vice president position, but building up experience over time, whether it's on the board of directors or other very high posts, you need to be able to nurture a large number of women so that eventually they can rise to the very top posts.
どうぞ。はい、あの、いや、非常にはっきりと全体の組織のレベルが上がると思います。女性が増えることで。 で、それは女性のスタッフや教員やそれから学生が増えることで、ある種の知的レベル、今まで知的レベルと思われていなかったレベルもあるかと思いますが、で、女性は多様なんですね。女性の中の多様性というものがこう発揮されてくることによって、組織全体の多様性が出てくる。それからもう一つは、民族的な、マイノリティに対する理解、その他、そういうものが出てくる可能性がある。 で、そういう意味で様々な意味で、社会的な質が上がると私は今は考えています。それは長い間そうなった時に堕落するかもしれませんが、制度的な改革をするよりもむしろ今女性を増やすことによって大きく社会は変わると思っています。
I am absolutely convinced that by having more women at all levels of society in different organizations, the entire level of the organization will rise and only be enhanced. When you have more women who are not only faculty members, but are staff and also students, you see that the general level of the intellectual level of the entire organization also rises. The reason I say that is that women have some distinguishing characteristics. By having women, you introduce a great amount of diversity into an organization. Women are also more adaptable to others. They also, by having more women, you will have a further, a deeper understanding of the problems faced by other ethnic minorities, for example. I could go on for some time about the many, many variety of benefits that inclusion of women in society will bring to the overall level of society. I think society overall will improve in quality. Of course, this is a longer term process, and I think, however, by encouraging women to become more part of society will bring about a better change in society than having some kind of dramatic sort of forced upon kinds of political policies.
Just very quick comments related. I agree with the Tanaka-sen's comment. There's actually empirical evidence that the rise, increase in women's ratio go hand in hand with the internationalization because that's basically diversity and the organization become more inclusive.
Okay, thank you so much. Very unfortunate, we've run out of time, but really, really enjoyed having you three here. Thank you so much for everything. And we have a club tradition where our speakers are invited for a one-year membership.
Yeah, so
you know,
so. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Tanaka-san, one of your membership, please come. Thank you. Please come and visit us often. Yeah. Thank you so much.